हेलो।
हाँ हेलो।
यस सर, वी आर जस्ट चेकिंग।
ओके okay. Hello, sir. Could you able to join? No problem. Please, please take. Yeah, bye, sir. Thank you.
So let me welcome Professor Mukesh Sharma, today's speaker for the third lecture on air quality management lecture series. Good afternoon, sir.
Oh, well, good afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone. Very nice to be with all of you for this SEPA network and many institutions involved, and I'm already seeing many people joining. So I'm grateful to everyone.
So good afternoon, sir. Good afternoon to everyone. Thank you very much for your support for this air quality management lecture series, which is a kind of new initiatives in India to spread awareness on air quality management to the younger and also the learned people, and bring some platform to share this experience across the country. So this particular lecture being organized jointly with IIT Madras, Department of Civil Engineering, then SEPA network, which involves 10 leading institutes across the globe, and then our Indian International Conference on Air Quality Management. So we have a very special speaker, and which you know that when you heard about Professor Mukesh Sharma, you all aware of it, that Air Quality Index is the one which is a pioneer in designing the air quality index for the entire country. So you are aware of it, and Professor Sharma recently also been it's a great honor for me to again indicate that he was been awarded a lifetime air quality management lifetime achievement award from the Indian International Conference jointly organized by Australian National University, Bathi University, and Almouth Center for Environmental Research and IIT Madras. So now with this few words, I request Anju to give a brief overview about the speaker. I welcome Professor Mukesh Sharma. It's a very, very great honor to all of us, sir, to listen to you. So now we will just briefly present your speaker profile. So over to Anju.
Thank you, Professor. Hello, everyone. A very good afternoon. It gives me immense pleasure to introduce our speaker of the day, Professor Mukesh Sharma, Department of Civil Engineering, IIT Kanpur. So we all know that Professor Sharma is going to talk about the challenges and strategy for abating PM2.5 solution, a case study of National Capital Territory of Delhi. This is very relevant topic in the present time because this air pollution status in Delhi has undergone many changes in terms of levels of pollutants and the control measures taken to reduce them. Professor Sharma's research interest includes air quality modeling and management, fade process of organic pollutants, and parameter estimation. Professor Sharma is elected as a fellow of National Academy of Engineering in 2014. He is a recipient of many scholastic awards like Hongfa Award in Air Quality from Clean Air Asia in 2012, Japan Society for Promotion of Science Fellowship in 1998. He is also recipient of Ministry of Environment Canada Award for Excellence in Research and Technology Development 1994. He has received a Commonwealth Scholarship from Canada in 1994. And he is recipient of Faculty of Engineering Award for Excellence in Graduate Studies in the University of Waterloo, Canada. Professor Sharma is the distinguished tutor recognized by Academic Senate IIT Kanpur for many courses like Engineering Graphics, Advanced Mathematics for Civil Engineers, Air Pollution and Its Control Engineering. So while not saying much, I guess this is the time to listen our speaker of the day, Professor Mukesh Sharma. Over to you. Please enlighten us by sharing your experience. Thank you, Professor, joining us today.
Well, thank you very much, Anju, and many friends I can see for joining. Thank you, Shiva. Thank you, Dr. Tyagi and Dipankar, and all our very close friends, many of the new persons on the board. So I'm really grateful to all of you. So we'll sort of, as we all do, take help of certain slides so that, I remain focused. What happens with experience is there's a tendency to drift, and then the drift sometimes can take you away from the the focus. So it's a good idea to use certain slides. And not only Delhi that I'll talk, and I'll talk certain basics and some of the issues, and also very briefly talk about the national air quality standards. Why about national air quality standards? Because those are the basic foundation of air pollution control, monitoring, measurement, actions, all just hinge onto this foundation stone of air quality standards, actually. The standards are very important and very legally enforceable. And the entire structure of air quality management, including could it be receptors or to the source or to the all the stakeholders are involved, because we want to comply, we want to achieve, we want to attain these air quality standards. So that is what is the basic philosophy of any air pollution control system that we create in India. And then obviously we want to bring in the regulatory sense, regulatory meaning to the whole thing, so that whatever those standards are there, they are sort of enforced actually. So I'll take help of some slides. So if you allow me to share some slides, I hope I can share. So I hope you can see the slide. Can someone just sort of?
Yes.
Excellent. Okay. So again, well, I understand lecture number 3 at IIT Madras being organized by them. So we'll move on and we'll start with the first, this thing. See, the way I see the air pollution is, it is essentially a pentagon. And it is something like this, that air resources that we have. So we want to restore the resources, okay? So there are certain, obviously there are some degradation of the resources, and one of the objectives that we see is to restore the air resources. And it's definitely, in my judgment, probably you may not have seen anywhere, it's essentially a pentagon of issues, and then there are certain branches and sub-branches there, okay? So let's very briefly discuss what is this pentagon. It's nothing to do with the pentagon of US defense system, but this is the pentagon of air pollution. Or let me put it this way, see, or we are trying to say, how can we restore our air resources actually? You know, normally we talk about air quality. The quality is one part actually, but then overall in a larger context, it is a resource, okay? It's a fantastic resource, a very, basic sustenance of the life depends on the resource actually. And what is the big thing, or what is a great thing about this resource, is that, well, God has given this resource identical, uniformly to everyone, every part of the earth, every individual person, to every group, or to the whole, you know, like there's no biases from the Almighty when it comes to this particular resource. Rest of the resources, you can say, well, oil is available somewhere else, you know, the gold might be somewhere else, and then, you know, aluminium may be somewhere else, somewhere it may not be available. But air is the one resource which God has given us equally and uniformly. And what happens is largely it's we, those who are the primary user of that resource, only sort of deplete in certain sense. Okay, so this is an important resource, and so we will talk about that. So the issue of pentagon, the way I see the whole problem, is first of all, we need to know the state of affairs of our resource. And just not knowing the state of affairs is there, what it means, what it implies, what is the impact? Is that impact okay or acceptable? Well, we don't need to even further talk about it, and we just sort of relax and, you know, enjoy the resource, such a fundamental or such a basic resource. So assessing the state of affairs is important, and then the potential impact. So the second, within this one, when we talk about the issues for the state of affairs, they could be local issues, there could be global issues, and the regional issues. The point is that, well, you'll understand that, well, why we're talking the three contexts of the issues. The issues, local issues, are something which requires the local solutions actually. regional issues will require the regional solution, regional dialogue, regional discussions, you know, more than one, maybe more than one state, maybe more than one country, they have to sit together. And global means the whole world, the entire states or the countries have to sit together and solve the problem. And obviously, these problems, when we go to the global scale, this problems become very complex and very difficult. You know, we all know about the positions different countries take for the global control of, you know, climate change. And but so in a way, what I'm saying is that the local issues, well, it's all up to us. The global issues, you will say, well, X country is not doing anything. The Trump administration didn't want to do anything about the CO2 control. They say we're already doing our best already. So the global issues, the challenges are more complex and tedious. So local issue, it means local issue are within our framework. So it's all the more easy to do it. So that's, let's focus on the local issues. That's why the focus will be on Delhi. So now once we have the issues are there, so issues have to be resolved. So how do we resolve? There has to be a regulatory framework. Because either you leave people to their own judgment and you say, honestly, do your job. But obviously, I mean, something, you know, people don't do. So there has to be, the law has to be brought in. More stringent law means there's a more tendency to bypass a more common sense kind of thing to save the or to restore the air quality. So there's a regulatory framework which comes into being. Regulatory framework, what would be the basis? It has to be essentially environmental health, means health of the people. So how do we do it? So we have to maintain, we have to manage, we have to ensure that good quality of health to the our own citizens. Okay, so we have to have certain norms, and that's where the issue of environmental protection norms come into being, and then air quality standards, air quality norms also bring this in. So it is essential that air quality norms must sort of connect to the health issues, actually. You know, there's no point having some sort of law which is not protecting the public health, actually. So therefore, this is important. Third is that once we know there's a problem, okay, and then we have a certain targets to meet our environmental norms, actually. So how do we go about doing it? So we need a strategies. You know, after all, the humans can think, humans can design certain things, humans can find the solution. So strategies and engineering control. So that's all. The third column of my pentagon, if I can say, is strategies and engineering control. So we have to find the solutions, actually. So the solutions have to be optimal, not too expensive, and the solution have to be effective as well. We must ensure that we are getting the right air quality we are able to restore. Okay, the next is, of course, I talked about the global warming issues. So global warming is important. As I said, the issues are far more complex, detailed, difficult to solve, actually. So those issues are also there, the greenhouse gas emission, the Paris Agreement, and the agreements earlier than that one, black carbon emission, the glacial melting. So these are the issues related to the global warming. And I can talk about these issues, but for the time being, we are more trying to be on the right-hand side of the Pentagon. And lastly, which is somehow has been ignored for quite a while, is the indoor air quality. And indoor quality has to be, it's very interesting about the indoor air quality, is that it sort of differentiates between urban and poor, and it's also differentiates between rich and poor. Rich can afford anything, and poor sort of cannot afford certain things. You know, you can, you know, you're rich, you can buy n number of the cleaners or indoor room cleaners and all. What about the poor person? Okay, he cannot afford that. So we also have to think about the air quality, and air quality management is also important. And don't forget, indoor air quality and outdoor air quality are also connected, actually, and more so in the Indian context, where we have very houses are not more ventilated probably than in European or cold countries. So with this basic framework, you have to understand, and then we'll talk about the issues more onto the right hand side, not touch the issues on the left hand side, but let's move on, actually. So within those framework, I'll say state of affairs and environmental impact. So let's understand that. First of all, this is a slide which I generally show to my first year or the first group of students actually. So don't forget that it is somebody else's responsibility to fix the environment actually. So if you go to our constitution and Article 51G, it states that it shall be the duty of every citizen. So our constitution itself is casting a duty on us actually. And how can we say, well, we'll not follow the constitution and don't follow and don't sort of obey with the, or don't sort of deliver to the responsibility or the duty that has been cast upon us by the constitution. So it says the duty of every citizen of India to protect and improve the natural environment, including forests, lakes, rivers, wildlife, and the environment, of course, is a far more bigger term. So air pollution is, or air resources sort of encompassed into it actually, and to have the compassion for living creatures. So duty for the citizen, but also duty for the state, means duty for the government actually. So what the constitution has done through the 42nd amendment is it also casts a duty on the state, that means government of India actually, frankly, in the directive principle, we all understand fundamental rights, and also the directive principle in the state policy for taking steps for protecting and improving the environment actually. So lastly, which is rather recent actually, and many of you who are in with the Pollution Control Board are very well familiar with the public interest litigations. So public interest litigation has to be further brought in. How this possibly this the PIS that came into being actually is because, you know, it's very interesting. You know, the Honorable Supreme Court expanded the scope and boundaries of the fundamental right. You know, and the Article 21 says that we have a fundamental right for the personal liberty and sort of right of life actually. We have, you know, constitution provides us the right of life actually, and the personal liberty. But what happened, the court sort of recognizes and took the cognizance of this thing that a right environment, suppose if it is not there, it means it is infringing with the right of life. It is infringing with your personal liberty. So it's simply not having a statement like, well, right to life. But right to life in under what conditions actually? So therefore, the under Article 21, the scope is further expanded, and the issue of, you know, nice and wholesome environment was brought into this. So court has interpreted the right of life and personal liberty to include the right to wholesome environment. Okay, wholesome environment means the totality of environment should be very conducive for a happy and very comfortable and with the, you know, with complete personal liberty that life is, it should be provided, and that comes under the fundamental right actually. So in fact, this public interest litigation have proved very powerful actually. This has opened the multiple avenues for the ordinary citizens, for the lawyers, for the advocates to take the point directly to the higher courts actually. You know, otherwise in the initial days who are from the pollution control boards, many things will be stuck at the session court and not move, and you know, issues were sort of that regulatory treats to the laws were not as good as what it is today. And we definitely see the changes because of what has happened over the last 30 years. The country has a phenomenal regulatory, the pyramid or regulatory structure that has come into being about the regulatory issues and regulatory framework in the country. It's very easy to say, well, this is bad, that is bad. But just imagine, had these regulations been not there, you know, you have to see the things in terms of, you know, in a very comparative sense. If suppose those laws or the pollution control boards which have come and they are doing their job, had those boards been not there, what would be the state of environment? So, you know, we have to change the way we think actually about this. Anyway, we'll move on with something else. So as an engineer or scientist, we know that there are the stresses, okay? We are familiar with the mental stress. We are familiar with the stress in the in the structure, the buildings and all. So air pollution is also considered as a stressor. Okay. So look at the left hand side, that blue remark. Okay, we basically need food, we need air, we need the liquid and the water. So normally you probably will need only about 1 kg of food at most. You'll require 2 liters of water. But the amount of air that you require to survive is like almost like about 90% of the total intake that is going inside the body. So air, apart from, of course, the food and liquid or water has to be very clean or very clear, but just massive amount of air that's exchanged, you know, continuously, you know, that is where the issue of there, that if there any issue, any problem with the air, it means it is going to impact your body in multiple sense, actually. So therefore, we have to think about the air slightly, I wouldn't say on the priority, but this is equally important as the quality of food, quality of liquid, and quality of water. So therefore, the air is a stress, and in order to fix the stress, we have to find some ways and solution to this one. So, okay, let's move on with this background, actually. So indoor air quality is important, no doubt. So issue, those of you must be quite familiar with PM10 and PM2.5. In fact, now even the media people know so much about this the feature of PM2.5 and PM10, but it's a nice idea to recap the PM2.5 and PM10. Interestingly, just to give you a little feel, PM2.5, of course, you can see on the right hand side, is acute respiratory system. It's a sort of toxicity and carcinogenicity is high. It can even lead to cardiovascular disease. Of course, the lung is a primary target, actually. And premature deaths, people have talked about it. And this PM2.5 is indeed very tiny, actually. So if you see the hair cross-section is about 70 micrometer. So it's even smaller, nearly about 1/20th, okay, of the size of the hair. So it's so tiny, absolutely. But there's so much in quantity, sometimes the air, they in fact, apart from the issues which I'm talking about, it greatly reduces even the visibility part. See, I mean, this is because many of our audience must be the young students and young personnel. See, always remember, it's quite possible that we may talk PM2.5 as the particles or the size less than 2.5 or equal to 2.5 micron, actually. This standard and right definition is not simply 2.5 micron. It is an aerodynamic diameter, actually. Okay, similarly, if you are really talking in technical sense, you would define PM2.5 are the particles having the aerodynamic diameter of 2.5 micron or smaller. That is how we talk about this. I could explain you about the aerodynamic diameter, but that will take some time. But just think that it is aerodynamic diameter. It means this brings particles can be of different densities. Particles could be of the different shape. Particles could be hollow. Particles could be, those of you might remember the term, they could be very senosphere. So these particles, you know, they're just not the same. Every group of particles could be very different. So in order to bring them to a uniform level or uniform platform, we define them in the sense of aerodynamicity. And as a result, we attach the word aerodynamic diameter so that there's a uniform scale for all different particles. Well, this should be, for the timing, should be enough. But there are a little bit of mathematics and a little bit of issue that why do we call it aerodynamic, actually. But for the timing, you to bring all the particles which are different shape, size, density, diameter, hollowness, we bring them to the level or the uniform level in terms of the aerodynamic issues, if I can say. So that's defines PM2.5, PM10. And people felt such a terrible issue in 1952 in London. You all probably know that. You can see here that, well, suddenly for some reason, which poor meteorology, high emissions, you know, there was a sort of smoke, which is sort of dotted line in the black, and the green is the one which is sulfur dioxide. So this mixture and high emissions and bad meteorology, okay, so always remember what things cause bigger issue, and that's what the issue that we get in Delhi, for example, in the month of late October, November, is increased emission and bad meteorology. So this combination is very, could be very problematic. Fortunately, it is not as bad as it gotten into London in 1952, but you know, like, but we have to, I mean, we have to not sort of get frightened with this one, but we have to be very sort of, you know, be very vigilant that, well, if, what if such situation occurs, you know, right? So therefore, the only thing that is in your control realistically is to control the emission meteorology. You just simply cannot control. So therefore, the focus has to be very much onto the emission reduction. And if you want to be a little bit more smarter, then you have to predict your meteorology, which can be very, very well been done. And then at least design a system. Well, then where meteorology is going to be bad, you know, we forewarn the people about their sources, not only emission control sources, but also forewarn the people about the bad, terrible air quality that might be there. So, you know, the knowledge or the science or understanding has to put to the use of the people's advantage. Simply not, well, of course, to do the science is important, but connect the science and engineering for the well-being of the people. That should be the fundamental thing. Well, of course, people, some of you are from the academic area, publications are important, but at least in my judgment, try to do the publication which connects to the people actually. Okay, there are other group people who can do it at the molecular level and what is happening in neutron and proton. But I think as an air pollution person, we should be more focused on to how and what way we can help the people, what way we can improve their lives, how, in what way we can reduce the exposure. So that has to be the focus actually. Let's move on. So this is what was the status when we're talking about the state of air quality. You know, I mean, look at these are the filter papers that we have done in Kanpur actually. Of course, sometimes back, they are not very recent, almost what, 15 years back, at three different locations. And you know, we might say, well, where is the pollution? There are certain group of people who say, well, pollution is not an issue, this, that. Okay, but this is what I think, this would be the air that's going inside your lungs. Okay, and you don't need doctors to tell you, you don't need great specialists to tell you what will happen to your lungs. Okay, so I mean, we know the problem at hand. Okay, we have to look for the solutions actually. That's what I was connecting the research versus how the people should get the comfort in terms of the air quality actually. So this is terrible actually. You just imagine the darkness of the thing. And this is not at the ground level. This was at the height of 3 to about 5 to 15 meters actually. So this is what is affairs even at that level. So ground level things could be even be worse actually. So remember that. There's a problem at hand. Not only the measurements what we did, but it's also the people who have compiled the worldwide data actually. If you see carefully, these are the developing countries in the top, okay? New York, Tokyo, Los Angeles, London. They are so clean actually, okay? But as we move towards more towards the developing country, Tehran, Beijing has improved a lot. Lagos, Dhaka, Mexico, Cairo, the levels are high. But apart from some cities in the country, which are largely at the South Indian coastal cities, our moderate cities, you know, Dhaka is a large city, Seoul is a large city, Beijing is a large city, but what is issue in our country is even moderate sized cities have very high pollution level. And that's a bit unfortunate. But of course, there could be many reasons as to why the levels are so high. So that reason we have to know, and we have to find the solution and constantly, relentlessly work on the issue of air quality improvements. And of course, it will cost a lot of money. Therefore, the people from the air pollution personnel or this thing, they have to constantly, you know, play their trumpet and say, look, we need more investment in this field. And you know, don't be shy of saying, well, air quality is bad and there's a investment is required actually. So this is what it shows that, well, are we really the worst? Appears, looks like, you know, most of our cities are in terrible shape. So this yellow line, as you can see, this is the WHO guideline. And this is our own national standards, you know, like PM10, this is annual standard. I'm not talking about PM2.5 also. Having said that, you know, at least not only we recognize the problem, the other countries also recognizing the Indian problem, actually, if you see it. Give me a second. Okay. So we also, sometimes back, this was nearly about 7-8 years back, PM2.5 measurements were not there, but we sort of derived PM2.5 levels for the different cities, you know, something like 61, 62 cities. There were some cities, you know, they were doing pretty good, but most of the cities, you know, purposefully put in the chronological increasing order. So many cities had many high pollution. For example, at 47 would be Delhi, okay, somewhere here. And Jalandhar is such a moderate sized city, and look at the pollution level which is there. So we have to find the solutions actually. Okay, what are the health effects we know? I mean, look at the American data. You must have heard the name of CDC a lot during this pandemic and during this coronavirus, the American CDC or Center for Disease Control. So they also have a lot of statistical data. It's a little old slide from, you know, a time series from 65 to 1998. You see the Americans, you know, they have been able to bring down the many diseases. Actually, look at the coronary heart disease, for example, definitely going down. And this is the mortality or relative mortality, if you like. So they have been able to bring it down very significantly, almost stroke, cardiovascular disease. But look at the COPD, which relates to air pollution, actually. Even if they are very clean and very nice cities, in fact, the issues are mortality along with COPD, which is the obstructive pulmonary disease, chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, that is certainly is increased. And therefore, I mean, we might have issues almost at all the diseases, but, you know, so the COPD or the air pollution also needs to be, we have to fix and find the right solutions for this one. PM2.5, we talked about in the beginning. Interesting part of the PM2.5, if you look at the PM2.5 under a microscope, actually, the PM2.5, you will see that PM2.5 is essentially looks like popcorn, actually. So it is not spherical, it is sort of, if you see under the microscope, it is a popcorn. What it means, like a popcorn? Popcorn means you have small particle, no doubt about it, but the surface area is very, very large, actually. You see here, this is the, probably we think it's a spherical particle, it is not. And actually, you see, it carries the native particle, which is sort of maybe the black carbon, for example. All toxic pollutants, you know, sort of get attached to it, in terms of, for example, lead, mercury, PHAs, furans, and pesticides and all, they get absorbed. Always remember, larger is the surface area, the tendency more to absorb more of the pollutants, actually. The absorption, it could be even possibly through chemisorption, or it's possibly through the van der Waals forces, so it get attached. So it is said that why so much about PM2.5? Because PM2.5, you can almost say it is a surrogate of toxicity. You know, we as an administrator, we can't run after every bit of the pollutant. There are hundreds of pollutants, but we know that PM2.5 is one pollutant which carries many other toxic compounds, actually. Therefore, focus on PM2.5. You know, suddenly things have changed from PM10 to PM2.5. So that's the purpose of showing this slide. It is like a popcorn, large surface area, able to absorb many other highly toxic pollutants. And don't forget, this itself is very small in terms of diameter. And so therefore, it'll go deeper and in the lungs and cause many more problems. I don't want to get into the details. It also implies that many of the small, tiny nanoparticles could get across from your alveoli towards the bloodstream. Okay, let's see. Next slide. So this is what I've already talked about to you. So now we are talking about the regulatory framework. So how do we know about the regulatory framework? So essentially, as I said, what air pollution system is called actually, it's not a very complex system. Of course, the internal details are very complex, but it has only three components. One is the source, okay? Another is the transport, okay? And another is the receptor. So objectively, what we want is to safeguard the receptor. So it's essentially when we are trying to solve this problem of air pollution, this is what we used to study as a reverse engineering or reverse finding the reverse solution. So we have to see what are the safe levels for the receptor and therefore what should be the emissions and what should be the reduction emission. But in the process, we also have to account for the meteorology, we have to account for transport, we have to account for photochemistry, we have to account for many physical and chemical processes which are happening. So this particular part is specifically very complex actually, the transport phenomena and the meteorology. And this not only too complex, too difficult, cannot be controlled, but at the same time, let me tell you that, well, of course you can't control them, but it's a highly, highly non-linear. So that's where, you know, we have to bring in the experts to give many answers. Well, what in a reverse way we can solve the problem. Okay, so here, interestingly, environmental regulations, which I talked about, the breathing level, but we have to go back and see, well, how and what way we have to reduce emission. So what we really want is sort of a linkage between what? Linkage between the source and its impact, okay, with respect to meteorology, which is highly complex and non-linear. So this is what is the linkage that we have to develop. Once we know the linkage, or let me use a word, once we know the cause-effective relationship between the emission and the impact it is causing, that is where, I mean, we start to find the solutions actually. So that's what is important actually, and we'll try to answer those things. So how do we make the standards? Many of the pollutants, you know, for example, the cancer-causing pollutants, there's some relationship between the probability risk of the cancer to the dose, what it takes actually. And the slope, which is with respect to dose, how much is the cancer potential or cancer risk. So this is what we call it, the slope factor, basically. So this is what is derived for many pollutants. That's where the toxicologist people, they come into being. And so for the pollutant, which is likely to be cancer-causing, this information is now generally available. Probably not for all pollutants, but most common pollutants, we have this information. Okay, so how do we, one of the simplest way to fix the standard actually. So, you know, I just defined the slope factor. Slope factor is what? Probability of risk divided by the dose. And dose is always in the mass per kg, body weight per day. That's the pollutant that you are taking in actually. So if I know the slope factor for the pollutant, okay, and if I know or I adopt a sort of acceptable risk, okay, so then what is happening? I can find out the dose, right? Well, three things are known. If I know this, and I know the risk, I can find out the dose. And this dose can be converted in the microgram per meter cubes of the air, which after this conversion, this is called unit risk factor. So simply you put the unit risk, whatever that you want to say, well, we'll accept, suppose the people in one person in 1 million get the cancer, we sort of say, well, it's acceptable risk. So 1 × 10⁻⁶, and then you have the unit risk factor for your compound, so you can find out, well, what is acceptable microgram per meter cube concentration. This is one of the simplest way to devise the standards. So in order to devise a standard in the country, we have done some sort of measurements. We have to look for the exposure. So this study was taken at IIT Kanpur quite some time back. You can also imagine from the old laptop. So what the people were requested, because they were highly exposed, so there was a pump which was sort of kept in their back, in the piggyback, and right here is the PM 2.5 collection system actually. Okay, and this is where, and this the collection rate was the same as the breathing rate actually. So wherever they would go, they'll carry this particular thing. So we will know their personal exposure. Personal exposure is sort of related with respect to the health performance of the lungs. Through this is spirometry, those of you might know this one. And with the spirometry, we can look at the many parameters actually, just to say, well, what impact it has caused. So there are again some mathematical models. I don't go to the differential equations and all and things like that. So these models will help you to assess the impact of the pollution. So we get the baseline, what pollution level will cause what. Because, you know, the challenges are there, you know, internationally, not many studies are available. But of course, the question will always be raised, well, what onto the Indian population actually. So at least some limited data was collected. And one way the data was analyzed, you see here, for example, on your y-axis is PM10. And on the right-hand side, the another parallel axis is delta PF. This is something peak expiratory flow rate. This is the lung parameter, actually. So many multiple people were used, and how all the people, in the average sense, how their lung performed. Okay, when the performance is negative, which is on the scale here, -5, for example, you see. Okay, and this is a decrement, there's a delta actually. So how much there was a decrement? So we could assess and establish the PM10 concentration versus the lung parameters on a daily basis actually, this is daily. So you see this, typically this is a mirror image that you see here. So this definitely sort of establishes that, well, pollution level and the lung performance are sort of inversely proportional or inversely variable actually. So this was very clearly established. Of course, it was published and all and things like that. But you also see here, for example, so if you have the concentration something close to 100 PM10, you can say, well, maybe the issue is not that significant because here the delta PEF is not as low as, you know, could be there. So, I mean, this helps you to get to the standards actually. Okay, this is another parameters for the different participants. This is the vital FE1 is the forced expired volume in 1 second. This is related to air pollution problem. So many people are having a lot of difficulties and lower performance. So solid point, for example, look at the mouse. So this is where the person should have performed ideally for his age, gender, weight, everything. But this is where he was performing. So there was about deficit of 0.39 liters of FEV1 volume. FEV1 is volume, so it's in the liter. So that ordinary people, you know, after the exposure, they were not even performing to their full lung performance. Similarly, for the vital capacity, that's the lung capacity, also people were not performing well actually. So the issues are there at this end. There's all this information, not only the national information, but the international information would go into the standard making. So there's also risk associated with the pollution level. Okay, there are certain models. They may not be perfect, but you see the model are not perfect, but they're certainly indicative actually. Okay, and we don't have to really, you know, pinpoint the numbers in my judgment, well, so much of the risk, okay. But we say, well, this is what is possibly a risk, high, low, medium. That is really certainly helpful from the model. So we run certain models for the North India, and we could say, well, the risk of, the, it was sort of cardiopulmonary mortality risk, actually. That was from the model, it shows was significantly high. One is a risk which is sort of almost no risk, actually, which is sort of relatively there no risk. But most of the cities showed very high risk, okay? And suppose we bring down the risk to about 1.05, for example. What should be the air quality standard? Of course, we are somewhere here with this diamond, blue diamonds, actually. So the pink line is what suppose I want to achieve. So in that basis, there's one way to sort of find out what would be the levels of the PM2.5. Having brought them down to such a level that my risk will be reduced to about 1.05. So at that time when standards were made, this was accepted, let's go for 1.08. So if you see here, 1.08. So that came the standard, one of the standards for PM2.5, one of the basics actually. They're far more complex, but I'm just talking the technical issue actually. So that standard turned out to be 40 actually. Similarly, you also argue with the government to say, well, if you do this, what it means in terms of the improvement, what in terms of the health benefits. So this is what you see, the blue diamond once again. This is the overall death that possibly could be prevented for the standard that was proposed actually, and which was significant. And PM2.5 death prevented with standard deviation, that's the overall death. And this pink one is death because of PM2.5 pollution. Because let's say that was 100, it is in percentage, will almost reduce it to about 80%. Okay, and overall death could be reduced about 18 to 20%. So these are models people can sort of argue, which is perfectly all right. You have to argue, we have to sort of, don't forget, if the things have to be criticized as well, always remember the criticism is not bad. Criticism is sort of, criticism in my judgment is a strength of the system actually, if done properly actually. Let's move on. I have to come to Delhi, and this is how you see standards are sort of published, and it's quite complex, but well, of course, you know, it is sort of a regular process. We should keep improving ourselves. In my opinion, the standards are simplified, that's even better. All right, we'll just move from here. Dr. Shiv Nagendra talked about air quality index that again was sponsored by CPCB, carried out at IIT Kanpur. And this kind of figure, this picture, you know, all diagrams and figures are the name. This figure, those for the youngsters, you know, they may not know this. Such a figure is called sunbeam figure. You know, we all plots, pie plots, and you know, linear plot, nonlinear. These are called sunbeam plots. Actually. So we designed it for the air quality index just to show that, just for the fun of it, actually. So those of you, since most of you are related to air pollution, you know how to go to the website, look at the air quality index, what potential impact it could possibly have. And this has proved very useful, actually. Let me use that word. And in fact, this has proved as a game changer as regards to air pollution control. So we'll not talk about so much of AQI, maybe on some other day. Again, it's a full lecture in itself. So we'll skip that. And then we'll talk about the, so we probably have the issues. I showed you certain measurements and all. So what are the strategies? Okay, so here is a case study of Delhi. This is what I was intending. But I just thought, you know, I've came to know there are quite young people and young professionals are also there. Well, of course, apart from many very experienced and very knowledgeable people are there. But that might be slightly, you know, might sound very, very naive for them what I've talked about, but also we have to focus to our young students and young officers as well as young personnel who might be joining the presentation. So that gives a basis for the air quality standard. So we talk about Delhi. So essentially the way the system should work, you have the emissions, for example, on the left hand side. These emissions have to be very categorically seen in terms of the lot of meteorological measurements, okay, and we must be able to model it. And then the model tells us, you know, either through the measurements, but measurements we can't do everywhere. So model will tell us where the people are exposed and which group of the people, which part of the city has to be sort of cleaned up. So it gives us the idea so that, you know, we give the better air quality to the people. And why we talk about this thing is that exposure has the problem. Exposure means again dose response issues. So we need to bring it down actually, doses. So we have to go to a tool, what you might, some of you might be knowing, cost benefit analysis. Because here also we can't make this the standards of the emission very stringent. But this is part of our economy, part of our sort of, you know, we survive because of the economy actually. So there has to be some cost benefit analysis have to be done. And then as a result, generally, yeah, it works out in favor of pollution control rather than, you know, that, like that, well, they, as if health benefits are not big actually. Health benefits are indeed very big actually. Okay, and also the issues, those who might be following the international publications, you know, COVID and air pollution have been very, closely related. In fact, the COVID issues have been related to the air pollution also, actually. But leave aside that, that is the latest science actually, but air pollution health issues are important and we need to control, and this is how the entire mechanism should work actually. So coming to the Delhi, so we'll talk about Delhi in a minute. Just give me a break for 5 seconds. I'll have some water and you can also relax for a while, I guess.
Yeah, meantime, please, if you have any questions to Professor Sharma, please use the chat box to type your questions there.
So Shiva, I hope everyone can hear me.
Yes, sir. Everyone can hear you, sir.
Perfect. Well, so now the issue comes, well, we have to start when we are doing something, we have to start with an objective. Okay, we don't start our studies or science or anything, anywhere. You know, you might be a student, you might be an administrator, or you might be a pollution control person, engineer at the pollution control board. You have to have some objective on certain targets. Well, objective is more better term. Within the objective comes the targets. So we started this study with how to attain the national air quality standards in Delhi. As I said, that we'll talk about Delhi specifically. So we thought there are three components to go for this work. We have to do some air quality measurements to see the current status, how bad it is there. If it is not bad, well, we might not do anything else. We simply go, you know, like, well, go home and enjoy the good air resources. Then otherwise, you know, we have to identify the sources, okay, and do what we call the emission inventory. Those of you might be knowing about the emission inventory. Okay, the fundamental thing about the emission inventory is try to cover even a small source. Don't say this is a small source, well, you know. So every small source has to be covered. This has to be a very thorough job, actually. And emission inventory, interestingly, is both spatially and temporally sensitive, actually. So we have to have the sense of a spatiality. Of course, when we are doing at the city level, spatial variation is very important. If you are doing, for example, at the state level and all, well, we say, well, the spatial relevance may be less. You know, X state is causing that many emissions and the Y state is causing that many emissions. But if you are finding the solutions actually for the city, then we have to have good emission inventory, which is spatially relevant. And then the third part, or third pink block, as you are seeing, is the quantification of source contribution to air pollution. That is what we call a source apportionment. You might have studied a lot or heard a lot source apportionment. So what is that source apportionment? It's to sort of apportion the contribution of the sources at the breathing level. Okay, so that is important. Emission inventory gives you some idea about the source apportionment. You know, don't forget that it doesn't give you much about this one. But realistically, interestingly, a larger source may contribute small amount actually at the breathing level and vice versa. So this connection of having the quantity of sources contributing to the breathing level, that's called the apportionment. Okay. So once, or let me again put it this way, the same way which I talked about, it is sort of a linkage between the emission quantity and the impact it is causing. Or as I use the word, if you remember, the causal relationship or causal linkage between the emission and the impact at the breathing level it is causing. So that's what we call as the source apportionment study. So it is essentially, we are, in a way, what we are saying is we are getting a relative sense of the contribution of the various sources. We can fix the priorities actually. And then we have to, for those sources which are important, we have to find out what are the options. Okay, so not only finding out the option, but what are those efficacies of the options, you know. So we need to have both identification of the control option, judge and find out how effective that source, that control option is actually. And then finally, make a time-bound action plan, convince the people, make several presentations, and let the people accept it. You know, if you do the quality work, then people will accept, people will do something about it, actually. So this is what strategically we sort of went about doing in this manner. But you know, the objective is to attain the air quality. Always remember, the objectives are simple. The complexities are there in how to achieve that objective. Okay. Let's move on. So what we did, we selected some 6 locations in Delhi. And these are the location depending on different land use, Dwarka, Rohini, Okhla, Vasant Kunj, Dilshad Garden, and that was Pusa Road actually. So these are the different pollution issues and all, but these need to be identified separately. So we, first of all, I'm showing the measurement results. So these were the locations where we did the measurements. One is Dwarka, second is Rohini, third is where we are third. Third is Okhla, fourth is our Vasant Kunj, and fifth is Dilshad Garden, who knows about Delhi, and sixth is the Pusa. So it's also very important, actually, I'm not showing that thing, to generate this kind of map, this kind of land use map. So don't forget, this map is looking very nicely on top of this, but this has 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 different layers. And I can look at each layer on the GIS platform. Those of you young people, do learn GIS, no matter wherever you are, what your subject area you have. That's absolutely necessary to sort of understand the knowledge, understand the data, storage of data, utility of the data, everything. So I can dig out every information from such maps, which we created for Delhi, actually. This is the airport, by the way. And different layers, and I can look at the intersection of layers, I can look at the union of the layers, I can add the emissions, I can subtract the emissions, and I can do anything with GIS. So always remember, it's always a good idea to make a good map. I can only look at the roads, I can look only the railway lines, I can only look at the agriculture area, I can only look at the water resources if I want to look. Okay, and that to not only look, it look means there's an associated information underneath that. So I'm just not the look, but I have the full knowledge of the information. Okay, the information gives the information leads to knowledge, actually. Okay, and knowledge leads to victory, if I can say that. Okay, very good. So we did the measurements in summer and winter because the emissions are very different, concentrations are different at different depending on different seasons. So the monitoring results, I don't know why I have Taj Mahal picture here, but just show you the monitoring results. This picture, we took it from Dr. Deepankar Saha, sometimes long time back actually. But anyway, this was not related to that. Certain instrumentation that you require, a lot of lab support in terms of many machines. For example, gas chromatograph, atomic absorption. This is a little old system, now we use ICP-MS. You have certain instrumentation with all calibration facilities. This is 4-channel sampler, which we got from a project from CPCB actually. So you can do certain different PM10, PM2.5, and on different metrics of filters. Okay, and they're all instrument. The good thing about this one is they all are having mass flow controller actually. Slowly as we become more good in terms of our measurement, always remember, instrument without mass flow controller is very primitive, I would say. Okay, so we ensure that whatever sampling analysis we do, we have the associated mass flow controller, and don't forget, almost routinely you have to calibrate your system. Okay, so these are the results. Our results are generally higher than many people have reported, but whatever number comes, you have to report that. Only what you can do is that we can apply best of your quality control and quality assurance issues, but whatever it comes, do show confidently. Don't worry somebody what they will say. Well, as long as you are satisfied, so be it actually. So we got this one, levels were very high for this, what we are talking about, PM2.5. Just imagine the standard was 60 at Rohini, for example, very high, okay? And some of things slightly come down, but not so significantly either. So this was W stands for winter, S stands for summer, actually. So winter, summer, you see the concentration, you can, on average concentration, you can very easily see about 300 plus, actually. And summer also, it will be nearly be about 300. So it means it's very high PM2.5 levels, 4 to 7 times higher than the national air quality standards in summer and winter, actually. And this is, don't forget, this is the average of 20 days average, but peaks could be still be higher, actually. So anyway, the overall average concentration of PM2.5 in summer is slightly around 300. And the ratio of, did we show the ratio? Yes, winter 0.63 and summer slightly less. So I would say in Delhi, even in the ratio is reasonably is sort of high, I would say, compared to what we get in Jaipur and Rajasthan, actually. So it means there is within the PM10 also, there is a significant amount of PM2.5. That's what it's suggesting, actually. Okay, so we are dealing with high pollution level. So we have to do something about it. We also did some measurements just to in the NCR region, Noida, Ghaziabad, and Faridabad, limited sampling, about 4 or 5 days. And you can see even the places like Noida, Ghaziabad, the levels were high, especially look at the winter, actually. Almost like cutting down to 500, 600, but these are the fewer samples, okay? Not so easy to compare with 20 days average versus some 3-4 day averages. And these were the winter things. So just to show, the one point that we wanted to bring to the fore was that it's just simply not Delhi. It is a larger area, larger region, which is in bad shape, actually. Okay. This was NO2. NO2 was, at that time when we did the measurement, was just sort of exceeding the standards, our standards. But I understand in some analysis that we have done, now NO2 is also very, quite significantly, I would say, at least about 1.5 times the standard, especially in the winter, almost at all locations. So this NO2 wasn't very high in the NCR region, but Delhi, yes. So the second pink block, you remember I said the first measurement, second was the inventory. So we did the inventory, and how we did was to just sort of put them into different groups. Area source, point source, line source, which are largely the vehicles, every bit of vehicles, okay? And the point source, at that time when we did study, we had power plants in Delhi operating the coal-based power plant. Even Rajghat, those who know a little bit about Delhi, the Rajghat plant was, even Rajghat was in operation. Rajghat and Badarpur, actually. And then we have the hotels, restaurant. I said, in your emission inventory, don't try to miss out even on the small source, actually. If you have small source, not that you are just sort of going to ignore it, actually. So biomass burning, even account for aircrafts, DG sets, industry, even cremation that we considered. And then as a result, we did a lot of traffic counts, okay? Follow the traffic, actually just not the count, but you drive along with the traffic in what direction, how much are going, how much distance they are covering. And there are not many methods to find out the vehicle kilometer travel, actually. So that's what you can find. And that's, you see, this is one of the slides from the the land use map, one of the thematic layer which I was talking about. Okay, very nice. Let's move on then. So we could find out the overall emission inventory from the vehicles. See, it came quite a few from the trucks, actually. And then interestingly, two-wheelers were also contributing. Actually, even place like Delhi, almost about six, if you look at the total vehicular count, actually, or registered vehicle, almost 60%, even in Delhi, then most of the cities probably exceeds about 70%. But in Delhi, it will still be about 60% plus. The two-wheelers. So two-wheelers contribute also to PM2.5, and the four-wheelers, and in fact the buses. Of course, Delhi doesn't have many buses. They should have much more than what they have. But then this emission also was small because it is a CNG driven, actually. So four-wheelers and light commercial vehicles and the two-wheelers also were sort of contributing. In a cumulative sense, individually they will emit very small quantity, but this. So NOx will sort of skip. So the road dust is a very important issue in the country. Trust me, this is one important source in terms of the quantity. Many reasons that we will sort of skip for the time being. So we did a lot of road dust collection. and the dust was so much that reasonable dust could be collected, measurable dust could be collected, just simply handheld this thing. So this is, you cannot see probably, but there's a wire going and going to the car where, you know, with that plug-in thing that you can supply the power, actually. So this all certain square meter of the area is sort of considered, and traffic count would help us. And at multiple location we did, and we find out the PM2.5 emission from the road dust was quite high. I'm not going into formulation and sort of formulas and all. Trust me, these were the numbers that were coming this way. So, I don't know. So here, you see here, interestingly, how the scenario overall in the city looks like. The road dust was, let's see, where do we start from? Let's say we start from vehicles. So this is a vehicle, about 20%. Hotels and restaurant, not small, but 4%. And this is the domestic cooking. Most of the 80% people, 85%. Then this was about 2014 data, by the way. You know, things change also. But just remember, keep it back of your mind, actually, 2014 data. So almost still about 15 to 20% of the people were still using the wood, coal, or dung or whatever. So not the entire city was 100% in terms of 307, in terms of LPG actually. So that was there, quite a significant this one. And let me show you something. Okay, this 3% here, okay. 3% was MSW burning, that's what we could estimate. MSW stands for municipal solid waste, actually. In fact, you know, just to share with you, earlier studies that I had seen about Delhi, somehow this solid waste burning was not accounted for. You know, maybe we just thought, well, that's how it is, actually. So this is a reasonable contribution. 3% is not small, by the way. So this was the study which sort of pointed out that, well, MSW burning is a serious issue in our urban cities, actually. Anyway, so this is what is the broader assessment. This was nearly 60 tons of PM2.5 was emitted per day. Road dust, major vehicles, domestic, industrial point sources, because of the high control on PM2.5. There's only about 11%, and PM10 was nearly 3 times. Okay. NOx, we are not referring here, but the NOx, don't forget that NOx is again industrial stacks, the NOx, and this is the your vehicles. Okay. So the major emissions. So this particular thing is, I'm sure, reduced significantly because now the power plants have been closed down. So this is how it is interesting that we have to spatially locate the sources and spatially locate the emission quantity. So the broad sense, which I showed you earlier, this thing, the broad is okay. That's very good. But what is important is to make it spatially relevant, put it in the gridded form. So again, the use of GIS would come into this. And why we put in the GIS form? If you're going to use the model will take the emissions from the regular shapes rather than the irregular shapes that you might have in terms of the emissions. So GIS can tell you, even if you sort of click here, it'll tell you what are the industrial sources, what are the two-wheelers, for example. So that detailed information is helpful, actually. So this is what we would say that, well, the north of Delhi had a lot of pollution, even the concentrations are high. In north of Delhi, so is also east of Delhi. Don't forget, east of Delhi had very high population density, and as a result, larger emissions. Of course, now Badarpur power plant is closed. So this point, which you see here, tip here or here, there was a Badarpur power plant actually at the border. Okay, so this is the inventory. This is something I show even in my class. Earlier, I used to sort of lit up a cigarette. Not that I'm trying to promote smoking or something. But I want you to observe certain things here, okay? See, look, what is to be observed is, for example, let's take example of this cigarette, okay? Look at the tip of the cigarette is clean in terms of smoke, actually. But the smoke is formed later on, after some time. Okay. So sometimes what is happening, many of the gases which are emitted, okay, they would form the particles far away. You can see, well, the stack may look clean, but don't forget that it may still contribute to what we call as PM10, PM2.5. So here, same thing here, clean here, even here, and this is just a physical transformation, by the way. Chemical transformation will still be complex, actually. Look at the this vapor trail from this aircraft, actually. So at the tip of aircraft, everything looks clean, okay? But the particles, you know, at least I'm giving you the sense, actually, they could be formed later on, actually. Similarly, this plane has just landed, for example. So with this landing, okay, it sort of leaves a puff. So initially I thought there was a lot of dust on the runway, but on the runway the dust was not there. And this I simply I observed it while sitting at the airport. And you also can observe, go to the airport, the plane will sort of, as it lands, there will be a lot of puff going out. So it is not the dust, it is the tires that sort of burns out in their volatile gases, actually, and they turn into the particles. So this phenomena, I'm just giving you one as a cigarette example. So these kind of things are happening at so many points in the city. So don't forget that looking alone at chimney will give you the full answer. That is the idea of this thing. And that's what we tell to the students and, you know, explain. So this is where the issue is, that, well, you have not many emissions. We call them primary emissions, which are directly happening, but through the photochemistry, largely, they turn into something else. They turn into, SO2 turns into the sulfates, for example. NO or NO2 turns into the nitrate, actually. VOCs and NO2 turns into the ozone, actually. Some of the PAHs can be formed or turned into the particles, actually, okay? So this is how, so when we are trying to find a solution, don't think the solution is simply lying of controlling our particles at the source. Because, you know, there's something else which are the gaseous in nature could turn into the particles. So this is what is important. Sometimes, you know, the earlier tendency, like before 2010, you know, the entire focus was onto the particles. So slowly we are changing, slowly we want to improve our environment. And as we understand, you know, we have to even go and get down to controlling the gases as well. Now, the third pink block, that is what we are talking about, source apportionment. So here, what we have done is, one of the ways is you have done the measurement at the breathing level and trying to say, well, what are the sources and in what quantity they are contributing. So this is what we have to understand. So once we know the link, well, here the breathing level vehicles are primarily responsible. Well, why should I go and disturb the industry, for example? Okay, we'll say, well, vehicles have to be cleaned up, or the road alignment has to change, for example, or constructive flyover, or whatever that you want to do. You know, like, you're open to that. But that, it helps with the prioritizing the sources and giving the relative importance, relative contribution of the source, where? At the breathing level. That's where it is. How do we do it, actually? In the another pictorial form, you can say here, you're doing the measurement at different places, you know, what are the sources being contributing and what quantity, that's what we want to find out, actually. And how do we do it? We go with the sense of, you know, I'm not talking about maths, by the way. Here, we're just understanding more from the concept point of view. So we are doing some, every source, these are the different sources. They have different fingerprints in terms of the particle chemical composition. For example, suppose this source I take. Okay, well, let me take some interesting source. Okay, let's take this source. So these are the calcium, that bluish kind of thing. So it means here probably this is the construction site or construction emission, which will have that many of calcium, for example. Okay, so every source has a very specific fingerprint to identify the sources, actually. So this chemical composition is one very good way of finding out the contribution, because we are able to compare the composition that we obtained at the receptor with respect to the fingerprints available at the source, so fingerprints at the source. So this is how we do it. So this is what information we take. Let me just briefly say here, it is exactly the way it works is the way police catches the culprit or criminal. So what they will do is that they'll take the fingerprint at the source, and then they will have their database of the bad guys, and they'll compare the fingerprints of what they obtained at the receptor at the point of site, and then they'll compare, run through their computer this thing, and they probably this is the person or group of persons did come on that site actually. So similarly, in a very, very similar concept actually, we apply that thing, the who have come here, okay? And then, we might trace them later on. The police also would not care how and what way they came through, as long as they know they came through. So similarly, we also don't apply the wind and dispersion in this particular case. We don't care how did they come, as long as they did come. Okay, so that's what is the one of the ideas to sort of do it. And this is what generally I don't show, but the molecular markers are very specific to various source fingerprints. So this something that will only be emitted by a particular source, actually, generally speaking. Okay, so then this is very special trick to target the very special sources and very clearly target that source rather than completely avoiding the ambiguity that you might have in the process. And we can clearly establish that these are the sources which are arriving or reaching at the receptor. So as I said, chemical composition is of utmost importance. So we did the chemical composition. You can see here, for example, winter. So metals are there, 27%, ammonium, sulfate, nitrate. These things, the ionic composition of these three things particularly, they account for secondary inorganic particles. Remember, we said that particles, the SO2 can turn into sulfate, NO2 can turn into nitrates, and ammonium, of course, is the emission which is also very plenty in the country. Actually, we never sort of regulate this source. Anyway, so these are three things combined will produce what we call as the secondary inorganic aerosols. So a certain part of the organic carbon is there, others which we probably could not resolve. Okay, we could not resolve. And then if you look at the metals, for example, okay, metal potassium, 30%. You just would wonder before even saying any maths, what is this 30% potassium is coming from and what it is doing here? Okay. And whereas silica aluminium, if we expect silica aluminium, so potassium is one indicator of biomass burning. Okay. So there some could be coming from partly, it could be coming from the forest fire, crop residue burning, and some could be coming from the local sources. This is difficult to distinguish between which is coming from, but certainly coming from biomass burning, wood burning, and that sort of thing. Wood would have little different thing, but largely the biomass burning and the other this thing. But when we came into the summer, actually here, you see here the massive contribution was that of silica. It means it is more of soil. It is more of, things get airborne, and potassium was significantly dropped. Aluminium, because that also comes from the earth and cement and all. Calcium also slightly increased, actually. Okay. Iron also slightly increased or about the same, actually. So you can immediately say, the sources are different. This is more to do with the dust, more to do with the construction, or this is the, and here most of the emission possibly could be from the, biomass burning. Okay, so we apply this thing and we can really see what are the issues in terms of what are the sources being contributed. And here we look at the winter, W stands for winter, and yellow. Biomass was consistently high at almost all locations. So it is not just a simple phenomena of some certain locality. So biomass burning in the winter is quite prominent, except I don't know why we got smaller here, but almost everywhere else actually. And then this, the orange color is the vehicles. So vehicles also in the winter, vehicles significantly contributed all the time actually. Okay. And the, on the top, this green and yellow, these are your secondary particles. So look at it in the percentage form, okay? Just look at the percentage form. Here, biomass burning could be, you say here, the, let's say 20 versus 50. So almost 30% could be coming from the biomass. Vehicle could be about 20-25% actually. Okay, so we could really break down the contribution of different sources actually. And then in the summer, you know, both biomass and vehicles have gone down, but a lot of this particular thing, what is that? Soil and road dust, okay? In the summer, you see, these emissions are very large, relatively. Okay, which was in the winter, they were nearly absent, I would say. Okay, so on average, you see here, almost like 20% of contribution could be from the road, soil and road dust in summer. With the winter, the biomass and vehicles and the secondary particles. Okay, secondary particles still prominent here. Secondary sulfates and secondary nitrates. The blue and green. So there could be about 20% or even more at some places, for example. So it was almost 20-25%. So the larger picture I'll show you, which for the Delhi that we got for the larger picture of, let's say, is vehicles were contributing even to 25%, secondary particles, massive. I mean, you know, we thought that, well, the particles are only primarily, but secondary particles means they are underlying precursor gases that have been responsible for the secondary particles. Biomass burning was significant. And what was really eye-opener apart from these things is the solid waste burning. Look, the emission probably was only about 3-4%. In terms of the total scenario, but in terms of the contribution to the breathing level, it accounted for 8%. Okay, so they look at the non-linearity between the emission quantity vis-a-vis the possibility which they can contribute. Okay, and don't think this is just it's a simple picture here. This is much, it is telling us a lot many stories, and this is simply not based on 1 day measurement or 2 day measurement. Okay, this is a measurement done at 6 locations for 20 days. So this is data nearly of 180 days actually. So we can't sort of disregard the findings, okay? And so secondary particles, vehicles, biomass, and MSW burning. I mean, and then who, I mean, simply, I mean, suppose if we can control MSW burning, our air quality will improve by 8 to 10%. And why not? And do it. And maybe it's not so difficult. Okay, all right, let's move on. PM 2.5 summer was soil and road dust was very high. Coal and fly ash was again very significant in quantity. So in the summer, things are largely the airborne because of the gusty winds that we have. So this is a picture, of course, you must have seen n number of time actually. So what I want to indicate to you actually, people make this argument that, well, emissions are there, no doubt about it. And then they say, well, pollution level is not that high here. Don't forget the pollution may be still be forming as it is traveling actually. What we call it is secondary particles. You know, well, I showed you example of, you know, cigarette burning or the 30%. So they, and don't forget, you know, this burning, it produces a lot of volatile organic compounds, okay? Because, you know, it just burns, you know, it's not fully burning also, not like a controlled combustion. So these VOCs will emit, and then VOCs, they turn into the particles by virtue of condensation, chemistry, and nucleation, actually. So I can't explain much more than this for the timing. So particles are still forming. And then they follow, the wind is, wind, for us, wind is not from north, okay, because we still have the Himalayas. So our wind comes from the northwest, and winter also comes from the northwest. And then it can also bring a lot of moisture because in the Central Asia, we have huge lakes. They are like oceans actually. So moisture also comes in, the fog and all can be brought inside this one. And then as a result, along this side is the Himalaya. So the tendency of the wind pattern is to travel along with this one. And apart from these emissions, we have massive, very large cities, you know, state of Uttar Pradesh, about 22, 23, 24 crores of people. Okay, nearly one-fifth of the population. And they are having a lot of many activities, the industry, cooking and everything. And as a result, there's a massive problem actually. All right, so biomass burning, we also wanted to show that, well, indeed, biomass burning also has the thing in the, it reduces even in the winter. In the November, it is very high and pollution levels are high. But they do reduce actually with respect to time, but they are not insignificant either. Almost still hitting to about 40 to 50 microns per meter cube when even entire farm residue are not being burned, but even then the biomass burning in the winter is high for many other purposes. This picture I particularly like. I took it from a friend, or he gave it to me. See, when they were trying to, this is a picture actually from Berlin actually. So if you have, you can even download this picture, not a problem. I mean, they have action plan for Berlin, the way we are trying to make it for Delhi or other cities and all. So they said the issue was only three. One is a regional background, okay? One is a contribution which is bluish, is from the urban background, urban area of Berlin, which is adding to it. And there are certain spikes, okay? Those could be traffic points, some hotspots and all and things like that. So three components. Okay, so similarly, our city or Delhi also will have three components. One is the regional background, it's contributed by the city itself, and there are certain hotspots. Okay, so if we break down this particular bluish thing, okay, so then it is sort of again, the entire thing actually. You see, in the Berlin, they got 47% was from the background. So this background thing, you as a city cannot do much about it. Okay. You can only do with a little bit here, but how much you can do? You can't bring the pollution level to zero actually. Okay, so entire problem, even if the Berlin was a very clean city, hardly 25 microgram per meter cube, and we are talking here 250 microgram, 10 times. Okay, so they also had the issue of regional background. In our sense, the regional background will be even more high. So what it implies is that when the pollution or the air pollution problem does not follow precisely the political boundaries or administrative boundaries, it is a regional issue, it's a regional problem, and must be dealt with the regional level actually. So, means we have to look at the problem in a much broader sense, simply not that Delhi mein ye karna hai, Delhi mein ye karna hai. We have to clean up the whole area actually. So control options, how do we decide to do this one? So we look at the thing is, we did not even prioritize the sources. Because Delhi's levels were so high, then we said, well, every source needs to be done something about. So we took the different sources of hotels and restaurants, cooking, MSW burning, construction and demolition, concrete batching. At that time, Delhi was under a lot of metro construction, actually. Road and soil dust, okay. Vehicles, industries, and DG says secondary particles, secondary organic aerosols. See, this is also very important, I mean, somehow it's completely ignored in the country, secondary organic aerosols. Primary inorganic, we do account for. So biomass burning. So we look at what are the possible options that can be done. Hotels and restaurants, well, we certainly came up with this point that, well, we have to stop using the coal actually. But they were specifically for Delhi because the study was for Delhi. LPG to all, we have to make sure MSW burning has to stop. Improve collection, because the problem was not with the burning. Problem was the poor collection actually. That's what we could clearly highlight actually. So if the collection was done, people will not burn it. When something is not collected, people will say, well, or how to get rid of. Okay, and some of the areas in Delhi were so unapproachable. You know, the vehicles cannot go and all. So, of course, there has to be some small rickshaws and all must go and collect this thing. And let me tell you, I've heard that things, I'm not from Delhi, not well, used to go to Delhi very frequently though, but things have improved. I mean, that's what I've been told actually. And people have taken this work or this report or this study very seriously. The construction and demolition, vertical covers, handling and storage of the raw material, water spray, store the waste inside premises, movement of vehicles. You know, the movement of vehicle within a construction area was causing so much of emission because, you know, the roads were completely unpaved. concrete batching, again, water spray as far as possible, windbreaker, back filters at the silos. This was one thing which we very clearly pointed. None had the filter at the silos. What happened? The silos are very large silos and they are sort of, you know, storing the material. When this material is stored, it replaces the air which is there in the silo. And that air, when it goes out, it carries the material along with this. So the standard thing is to have the silos on the filter onto the silos. Enclosures, hood, transfer points, telescopic chute. So these are the things that we sort of said, these are the possibly things that can be done. Road dust, vacuum sweeping, carpeting the shoulders, mechanical sweeping. You know, probably, I mean, we may get good results or we may not get results. But these are the primary options that we considered. For vehicles, we did talk about getting into electric and hybrid during that time in 2015, actually. Okay, now this thing is picking up, more has to be done. We also said that, well, the charging problem has to be dealt with. Now, of course, all the experts are talking electrical vehicle charging points. We did talk about in 2015, actually. Retrofit of the diesel particulate filter, we strongly recommended during that time, you know, that we have to jump to Euro 6, actually. Okay, from Euro 4, actually. And we, in fact, the government was saying 2024, we said, well, we should go by 2019, actually. You know, when problem is there, we have to go very rapidly. You have to invest, put in the money. I mean, after all, this is the health issue and we want to be better, you know. So 2024 and finally, you know, that was done in 2020, actually. I'm glad that it's done, actually. Maintenance of vehicles is very important. I'm not very fan of PUC, although it's a law, so we have to follow it. But the maintenance of the vehicle, in my opinion, has to be done by the expert. And we have written the report that there should be very serious, competent, authorized dealers. You go them just once in a year, and he should fix all aspects of your car, actually, cars or whatever vehicles. Ultra-low sulfur fuel, which is a requirement. And we also very strongly recommended that two-wheelers are our main forte for our transport for the ordinary people. So this two-wheeler is still on a, you know, that carburetor technology. So we said that new technology has come. So it should be more based on MPFI, that's multiple point fuel injection. That would really solve a lot of problems. But now I'm of the opinion that, well, two-wheelers should quickly shift to the electrical, this thing, you know. There's no need to have the electrical vehicle because, you know, the distance to be traveled is per day, maybe about 30, 40 kilometers maximum, even in a city like Delhi. So that is where we have to have the, that's where immediately we can do the electrification. So because of the very high high emissions of SO2 and NO2, high sulfate nitrates. So of course, this means a lot of money, a lot of cost, but we did recommend. And this sulfates and nitrate, they travel long distances, actually. So we said, well, there has to be desoxing, denoxing, and things like that. So what we did, I'll go rather quickly and leave for some point for the discussions. So what we did, we look at the efficacy. In the beginning, if you remember, we said we have to look at the efficacy of the whole thing. You know, we are not like an ordinary, we are not a journalist writing in newspaper that we make it a bucket list. You know, do this. You know, we have to ask, you know, doing this means what? Okay, so that efficacy. As an engineer, scientist, we have to give that answer, actually. So we run some dispersion model that I have not talked about to you today. But we said, well, if we do stop use of coal, what will be the control? Okay, very small quantity improvement, okay, that possibly small, but within that source, it will still be 67.5 or 80.56 reduction, okay. So we started with 330 or 340-50 micron per meter cube of PM2.5, the red circle that you see, and then we'll try to turn this red into green, actually, by our actions, actually. So we said, well, this is what we have to do. So what it means turning that little red into the slightly there'll be green. So we did this exercise modeling. You know, you're doing selective modeling for a source, actually, dispersion modeling. Now what you're doing is that you're running the model, which we did run air mode. So we are putting down the other sources to be zero and putting the source which we are considering for control. So this is how you can go about the LPG to everyone. Okay, so this slightly better green. Then we say stop MSW burning. So we said completely stop, no partial this thing that we'll do, we'll try, no, nothing. So, and then we said construction activities, what possibly can be done. So again, slight improvement, we are looking both improvement at PM 2.5 and 10, what possibly can be done on this construction side. Few things have been done, suppression system, slight moisture about 1%, no, I'm not talking about cement by the way, all other material you have 1 to 1.5% of moisture, lot of dust can be sort of suppressed. So we did the other suppression system. I'm just sort of, you know, running through them. Road dust, if you say we have cleaned the road dust, we look at the what is the efficacy of the various systems that are available largely from literature, not that we find out the efficiency ourselves, and that would have significant impact, you see here. Then we talk about road dust. Then we talk about the vehicles. It did improve, not dramatically, but it does definitely improve very significantly. So that again, we are turning this one into this one. And what are the all the actions that we said that if they are implemented, what it means in terms of the improving the air quality. So this again about the vehicles. So industries and DG sets. Okay, the DG sets are fairly quite a large number in Delhi at that time. You know, they have probably have come down because power situation probably wasn't that great at that time. We also recommended very strongly that DG sets are 2 kV and smaller, should completely be banned, actually, you know, so that, you know, everyone would have it and everyone will emit the, you know, black carbon and emission. So that either they should go for the, you know, what is that called? UPS or that, not the UPS, the constant power supplier, actually battery operated. Inverter, I'm sorry. I just forgot the names. So people should have inverter rather than, you know, having the small DG sets. We understand industrial DG sets are required. And then we talk about, this was the major impact, if you could say, that if we control SO2 and NO2 from many power plants, this will, you see, the problem could be, you know, if you look at the one plant and one process, well, they'll say the impact is only 1 microgram or 2 microgram or 5 microgram. But we have to see the cumulative sense, you know, like, so the sometimes tendency or argument, oh, well, we are not contributing anything. Well, as a group, everyone is putting in some delta X, and delta X added infinite times will produce infinite X. So we at least very strongly suggested that this should be done. Actually, secondary organic aerosols is a major issue in the country, actually, but not easy to control. Let me tell you. Reason is that, well, significant amount of biomass burning, significant amount of the domestic cooking. We are using many biofuels and things like that, and this Prime Minister Yojana, that Ujjwala Yojana, has played a tremendous role actually to attack both VOCs and secondary particles and all. We can talk on some other day. We have done a lot of work, and we said how significantly, you know, some improvements, almost all cities can sort of show some improvement in air quality. One of the reason is that, well, many of the villagers and many of the rural area have gone to the LPG side, and we strongly believe this LPG system must thoroughly and very aggressively strengthen it. Okay, this I'll skip. This is a little bit of more complication. It's saying that, well, PM 2.5, 32% can be secondary aerosol. So therefore, we have to shift from just controlling the primary particles, but also going towards the secondary particles. Means we have to control the precursor gases, actually. So secondary inorganic aerosols and secondary organic aerosols. This study we did at Kanpur. So nearly about 50% of PM 2.5 could be secondary. Means we have to, the arena of particulate control or primary particle control has to quickly shift to even the control of gases. So secondary organic aerosols you control, even then you are not meeting your standards. Biomass burning, some of you can find solution to it, that would have significant impact and will improve the air quality significantly. Lastly, how can we finally achieve our standard under difficult conditions also? We said, well, don't think Delhi to be Delhi alone. Delhi and surrounding area, let me tell you, is nearly about, we are talking about 6 to 8 New York cities put together. Faridabad, Ghaziabad, Palwal, everything, you know, from Delhi. So, I mean, we have to deal, and you know, you just can't clean Delhi alone. We have to have some mechanism that all those options I have told you, this option, the point number 13, what we are saying, all things must be applied to the entire NCR. So this will bring down the background pollution. You remember that Berlin paper I was talking about. So unless we deal the issue at the larger regional scale, you know, the benefits will not be that forthcoming. You know, Delhi is a large city. You know, we can do a lot, but also there's a limit up to which you can do. After all, people have to live, people have to travel, people have to cook, people have to go to the restaurants, and why not? So in that sense, you know, we have to deal largely with the regional problem, and of course, provide the best possible controls in the city of Delhi. So these are the basic things, and we also quantified in terms of how much will be the reduction in terms of the emission and in terms of the how much reduction level at the particular thing. And then finally, we proposed some time-bound action plan, which was very received very well, let me tell you. I mean, people are wanting to do something. Don't think people are just want to bypass the issues and just sort of, you know, do the eyewash. This is the one big change in the country in the last 10 years or so, is that seriously people want to do something. And with this, that intense urge and desire to do something, and I'm sure we'll be very successful actually. So there's some more time-bound thing, what can be done, when it can start, and things like that. So I also draw a parallel with respect to Chinese people, what they've done. So they also had a similar problem. So they also run such similar kind of study actually. And then they also wanted to focus a great deal, something very similar thing, not that everything is similar. So they committed something like 277, look at the bottom, left-hand side, $277 billion for their 5 cities in the over the period of 5 years, so that they could clean up the city. So it will require money, no doubt about it, right? Directional money, take our problem as a regional problem, and we can solve it. So, well, you know, won't be that easy that within a short time, but it's sort of relentless, complete planning, complete, you know, going after it would certainly improve the air quality, and especially when we are dealing with at a regional scale. So some of these reports, not that entire credit is for this reports and what the work which we have done. We recommended status was VS4 to 5. We also very strongly recommended to leapfrog. Okay, there was first issue with this petroleum policy was 23, 24 going to the Euro 6. We said this has to be done in 2019, we argued, but finally it is done in 2020. No road sweeping, something has started in Delhi, soil and dust control. Few things have happened. So, you know, things are happening. Let me put it this way, and I'm glad that things are happening, but it'll take a while before we can very proudly say that we are meeting our standard and we have improved their quality and better health for the people. So this report was picked up by the Niti Aayog, and they sort of, you can read here, there are several studies conducted by various institutions regarding deterioration of air quality. A recent and most comprehensive source portion study by IIT Kanpur, they used the data and information and came up with some more action plans actually. Finally, I'll stop there. I could go on, but I think we are done in a reasonable way, 15 minutes left. And thank you very much, every one of you, for listening so patiently. It's sort of not so difficult for me as a teacher. We always quite accustomed to give long talks, but it is your perseverance, your patience that you could sit through and hear me out. And so I'm obliged. And well, of course, there's some time for Christmas and Happy New Year, but well, till we meet again, my best wishes to you all. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Sharma, for a wonderful talk and a very comprehensive, not only for the students, even for the people who are also working to bring various aspects, starting from measurements to up to the control of strategies, which give some light to understand the problem and bring some awareness and bring some strategies for improving the air quality. So before we take, we will just give a small break, in a sense that maybe just everybody can just open the camera and just we will take a picture, because just to keep this as a memory, and then we will start all the questions which has been raised in the comment box. So I request everybody to just to open your camera, start your camera, and then we will start the discussion about various questions. Anju, are you taking the picture?
I'm taking the picture.
Okay.
Smile, please.
Okay.
I will share the document for the questions. A lot of questions we have.
Okay.
So that will be
okay. Anju, can you just send it to Professor Sharma, and meantime I will just pick up some of the questions, and maybe Professor Sharma can start give his comments on that one. Sir, one of the question which Professor Tyagi was, Dr. S.K. Tyagi was mentioned, can we include the noise and odor in air quality measurements?
Of course, noise is our requirement. So our legal requirement that we should do. Definitely odor has to be somehow, in this in our country, we simply don't care. So that is very important point. We should do it. This is a huge nuisance, actually. And we live with the area where the odor smell is very high. So we have to take it even some regulatory sense, even some measurements, especially for the reduced organic or inorganic sulfur compounds has to be done. And of course, ammonia. I travel to Delhi, and then I can, probably those living in Delhi maybe probably don't feel it so much. I can smell ammonia and H2S at many places. So this is, I've asked one of the students to look into this thing, that if there's anything that we can do. But exceptionally important point, because this is very serious nuisance. And one of the things is the also from our so many open drains that we have in our cities, so ammonia and the H2S, septic and anaerobic conditions. And we also have to see some of our wastewater treatment plant, they cause a lot of smell. And also the landfill sites that we have, okay, because they're right in the heart of the city. And there, it's not even a landfill site. This is a dumping ground, actually. And that's, in fact, this is one of the sources of pollution. There's a good amount of methane, good amount of VOCs that comes out from there. So, absolutely important point. And somehow we have been more focused on PM 2.5, but this is exceptionally important.
So there's another question, just maybe it may be relevant to everybody, just talked about wherever there is an air pollution problem, they said increase in COVID, and people are always relating, and you also mentioned that one. So is this, the second wave can be related to increase in number of, air pollution concentrations in the city?
Well, I do not know, frankly speaking. And then there's no scientific way, at least in India, I don't think anyone has done that. Specifically looking into that thing. But there are European papers, actually, those are interested. And they're almost attributing about 30% of mortality to the air pollution combined with COVID. There are certain papers, especially those which have come out from Europe. I don't know how far those are relevant in our country, actually. At least, and they're good scientific papers. I'm not saying those are in some ordinary journals, actually. So that's where the people have been reporting that. And potentially, difficult to say, but if there's a publication, then we have to trust those scientific studies done by many, many prominent people.
Sir, and another question, which now you know that there is in Delhi, they were planning to have a smog tower. So do you think that if you are increase more number of smog tower will improve the air quality in Delhi?
Well, that we have yet to see actually, smog towers. So it's a good idea that we are going to have some experimental towers right now. So we have to see how good they are and how good they are operated in long term. I believe maybe in the local area of at least, you know, some tens of meter either side, there would be some improvement. But some experiments and thorough experiments have to be done before we take a larger call of having many smoke towers.
So this is another question, because many young students, they are using different models. They will try to figure out which model should they use for social apportionment, whether PCA will be better, CMB will be better, PMF will be better. I mean, just to, for the younger scientists or younger student, generation to focus on social apportionment study, what's your advice?
I would say if you have very good idea in terms of your sources and their profile, okay, then go for your CMB kind of model. And suppose if you do not have very good idea in terms of your sources and their profiles, then the second choice in my opinion should be PMF. PMF is better than other factor analysis and all, and it can also tell you multiple sources. And third thing in my opinion, what they should do is first do the PMF, okay, and then make the sense of the whole thing, and then with some knowledge that now we have some broader sense they have, then they can apply for those sources, try to apply the CMB. So in my opinion, a combination of these things is not a bad idea actually.
So this is a very interesting question, but yes, restricted only to the metro. But I'm just thinking about in urban areas, there is an high-rise buildings. There is an increase in number of high-rise building. Probably it will reduce the ventilation aspect. Do you think that there should be some kind of an guidelines, city should have, so that they should look at it ventilation aspect also in, giving permission for this kind of an high-rise building?
Now what is happening is, of course, this is a very complex question actually. See, the thing is that as in the beginning I talked about the constitution and things like that. So the constitution provides that I can go and live anywhere actually. So almost, there's a significant migration of the people going towards the city in the job opportunities and all. So, I do not know, the city town planners must sort of decide on this thing, but to me the issue is slightly different. What happens when you have the large cities, it is those of you from the air pollution side, is that large cities act like a heat island actually. That's where somehow the problem, especially in the winter, would be very severe. So the Delhi's pollution, which is high pollution in the late October, November, one of the reasons is that, of course, apart from the emissions, it becomes an island in itself. The whole air is just recirculating because this urban area is a little bit more hot than the other things. As a result, this creates a low pressure at the center of the city. So the pollution from the all side, in fact, all from 360 degree sides rush into replace that air, which is a little hot and going up, which becomes cold and rebound back into your system. So the Delhi goes through this cycle actually. So the heat island effect would be a major problem in my opinion than the ventilation part of it. So that's where, from the air pollution point of view. But as I said, cities like Delhi, Bombay and metros, they probably will have to go for the multi-story building because of the space constraints that they have.
Thanks, sir. So this is still an issue which has been raised in several occasions, whether the CNG vehicles contributes smaller size particles and increases the health risk. So what's your comment on that one, sir?
Certainly, the particle numbers would be more from CNG, but the mass, as we understand, the mass issue is relatively very small actually. And also always remember the combustion in the CNG is slightly better. So you don't get that many of black carbon kind of thing. So the black carbon is also taken as, even the WHO takes black carbon as surrogate of toxicity. So in my opinion, of course, number could be higher, but toxicity level will be much less compared to what diesel is there. And I don't think anyone has really studied in the sense the number versus the part, number versus the concentration and their health implication in details in India actually. Mm-hmm. So, but by and large, I mean, you know, it's really easy to say that, well, CNG is certainly better than diesel and petrol, much cleaner fuel, no doubt about it.
So there's two interesting questions from our international experts. So one of them is, what is the source for the emission inventory or source apportionment, which results have come up? How did you, from where the informations arrived from this study? The second one is, the emissions used in this source apportionment, is it activity?
No, I probably missed it. The first question. Can you just repeat?
The first question is, the what is the source of this information with respect to the source apportionment?
Oh, this is our study.
Yeah, this is a study. I mean, it's a basically you carried out the study.
Yes.
Yeah.
That's correct. So
is there any some publications available? Maybe probably that could be
some publication. Journal publication is also there, and this entire report is available on the net, because this has been opened and anyone can download it, and many people have used it across the globe actually. So I can always send you the link in case they cannot find it. Just write Delhi source apportionment study IIT Kanpur and the link will come, I'm sure.
Thanks, sir. So for the second one, sir, question, what is the based on the activity for this emission sources? Is the source emissions what you are considering? Is it an activity based?
Yes, we, for the emission inventory, we took all the activity data for the different grids actually, how much fuel was being used, how much traffic was there, what was the road dust which was there, and so this is essentially based on activity data. So this is from essentially from bottom-up approach.
Sir, there's one question on how biomass and solid waste burning are separated, because is there any way, because both are coming from open burning, so is there any way to
see the biomass burning as essentially it's a sort of fingerprints are a little different. Largely the potassium is one which drives this one, whereas for the biomass burning, chlorine or chloride level are one indicator which sort of biomass burning, the plastic also would be burnt. So the chloride is sort of considered as a biomarker, and there are the profiles available. So I'm just telling you, not the biomarker, the first basic marker is the chlorine actually. Mm-hmm. So there's quite a significant level of chlorine or chloride compounds in Delhi actually. So that was taken as an indicator for the biomass, this thing. An entire profile was available, but the chlorine is the one which is a primary indicator of the solid waste burning, and there is a potassium is the one which will sort of tell us about the biomass.
Thanks, sir. So there's a question from the CPCB expert. So he mentions that the industrial, I think earlier one of your one of the theory report, your opinion on industrial contribution is about more than 11%. Is it, are you?
See, maybe, I mean, probably what we have written this as the contribution of coal and fly ash separately, actually. Mm-hmm. So it's quite possible they have combined the coal and fly ash in the industrial this thing. Then that's why their contribution is about 11-12%, whereas our industrial contribution is hardly about 2% or something, I don't remember. So they probably have used the fly ash and the coal as the industrial this thing, because we didn't want to put into the industrial thing, was that there are many other sources of coal being burnt, just not from the industrial processes. So that we didn't want to define it and didn't want to put exclusively in the industrial category. So that may be the slight reason as to why a few things differ. And in fact, it's always important that things differ and they don't match. If you match, then that's always difficult.
That's true. So there's one another interesting point which you also indicated in your presentation. The secondary aerosols contribution, like there are a lot of focus and there were a lot of reports related to that, and you also indicated something. So what's your comment on secondary aerosols contributions to in Delhi?
Well, that's very significant. About 30%, 25-26% is definitely secondary aerosols in the winter. And you have no choice other than controlling this emission from the large sources. But it's easy to control from large sources. It costs a lot of money. This is one of the more expensive than controlling the particles and all. But indeed, secondary aerosol is a serious issue. So the government has targeted the power plants, and power plants are sort of not very happy with it. But so be it.
Yeah. So there's one other question. Of course, there is a this question's related to the biofuels is accepted by farmers. Does government taking any sufficient action? So is what's your comment on that one, sir?
Biofuels
is accepted by farmers.
Like, for example, what would you think biofuel, the briquettes and all?
I'm thinking that maybe they thinks maybe briquettes is one such thing. Yes.
I don't know what is at the government level is happening, but I am of the firm view that whatever is the energy related material at the rural level, our villagers have or farmers have, we should take that one and give them something in the return so that they don't burn that. And whatever the energy related material which suppose burned in the open way is far more problematic. So this energy resources must be utilized in some other sense, not left to open burning or the burning which is currently being done. And after all, that whatever that energy is there, it is a property of the poor villagers, and they must be compensated. This is my personal opinion. This must be collected from them, compensated financially. And then we say, please give it to us. And they will happily give and say, please use a clean fuel. And this must be used in a very industries where you can do very controlled, proper firing and proper controls.
So there is another interesting question. It's basically to bring some awareness to the younger generation. So we are noticing these days very high-end bikes, high-end cars, high-end vehicles, they are coming up. Since their capacity is increasing, and probably they may also contribute more pollution to the ambient environment. So what's your comment on that one, sir? Because there is earlier all our roads are meant for 150cc, but people are even going for 500cc, 1000cc, those kind of vehicles. So what's your comment on that?
Well, certainly not good idea for the environment. but at the same time, automobile sector is a very prominent manufacturing sector for the country. Almost 50% of the manufacturing GDP is from vehicles. So we don't want to sort of scuttle the growth of vehicles. After all, as the prosperity comes in, everyone wants to have the vehicle. But what we need is really clean vehicles, better roads, less congestion. Okay, but certainly ordinary single person using 500cc bike, this is something which is neither exciting for the young kids, but not very logical.
There are another question related, so how local pollution, for example, how what's your recommendation for controlling the air pollution at local area in Delhi? I think you already touched upon those things in your slides, and probably this is a question just they wanted to follow.
First of all, clean and have very good quality of roads. Okay, let dust be not there. Second thing is identify your congestion points. When the traffic stops, it's because of the congestion. A clean BS6 vehicle will give you terrible emissions because you are supposed to be on the road for, let's say, half an hour. You spend 2 hours on the road. Then you have sort of defeated all the purpose. So decongest your city properly, smartly. Clean your roads. Make your points where the most of the people sort of agglomerate. Do the decentralization. For example, you have the one, suppose you have a bus stand, you know, so everyone will go to that bus stand. Okay, decentralize, have 4 bus stands in the city. Okay, so these are the things. Clean roads, MSW burning, you know, stop that one completely. Then identify your decongestion points. Okay, and then industries. If your city population is high, industries sitting inside the city actually, and first, you know, debar them using from the coal, and slowly, you know, our earlier concept of the town planning was very poor. We always thought that industry should be there. Industry should definitely be there, but industry should not be in the residential area actually. So we should even plan something slowly. I'm not saying that do it overnight. Maybe in 5 years, 10 years, 15 years, we say we slowly move the industries out of the residential. So these are the things that we have to do in short term as in the long term.
Okay. Sir, there's another question. Again, maybe you can already touch it upon, because this is more related if emission.
We have to stop at some point. I have another meeting at 4 o'clock.
This is maybe,
but please go ahead. Please go ahead.
This is maybe the last question. I will take it up.
Sure.
I'm sorry, sir. Actually, I do.
No, not a problem. Yeah.
You are given already. So this question is, how this PM emission sources like loading and unloading point in coal mines can be controlled, or how it can be modeled?
Modeling is there. There are certain models which are available for, especially for the mining purposes. That you can, of course, even USEP approved models are there. And loading and unloading control, you know, one thing is because the roads are not paved in the mining area. But if you can have slightly moisture content in that, whatever mining that you're doing, about 1% of it actually, and then control, and if you can sort of tighten all your transfer points, your sort of, crushers and all, because mining area do have the crusher, because, you know, by the time they send the ore and all this, sometimes at least bring it down to some size. So moisture, maintaining the moisture content seriously, having control at the crushing point, and then at least the roads where, you know, the roads are not paved actually, there's a lot of emission. If you can grow trees around the roads actually, that would significantly reduce the pollution, because then it will not be able to, you know, sort of will not be able to jump and go out actually. Not that the trees do anything, you know, this, not that trees filter the pollution actually, but they don't let it go beyond certain areas actually. Or maybe, and then certain areas they should also have the windbreakers and all and things like that. Well, cost money actually, but they have to do something about it.
Yeah. So thanks very much, sir. I think we'll stop now. There are 2 questions. You already answered it in terms of how CNG can be, you know, influenced in improving the air quality. We need detailed study on those aspects you already indicated. So on behalf of, all the air quality management fraternity, we would like to thank you for your accepting our invitation and sparing your valuable time and a very comprehensive, detailed explanation, your experience with more than, 3 decades or maybe close to 4 decades now with all the air quality management aspects, and particularly focusing on Delhi. So you have given a wonderful picture for entire segment of air pollutions in Delhi. So thank you very much, sir. So on behalf of IIT Madras and also the SIPA network, and International Air Quality Management, we would like to have a small memento, but we will send you through courier. Thank you very much. And we would also like to take this opportunity. Recently, we also, the whole country has also recognized you as an lifetime achievement award for the air quality management research. So I would like to take this to see if a few of them can just say a few words about their experience to working with you or your association with them, so that you can just I hope you are not in a hurry. No sir, just can we take another
few minutes?
A few minutes we will take, and maybe I'll just start with Dr. Madhusudan, and then slowly then we will move to the other Tyagi Saab and maybe other people, so that they can say a few words about you.
Good afternoon everybody. Being a former CPCB, and I am proud to be part of this discussion, and I am having immense pleasure to inform you that Professor Mukesh Sharmaji is also a CPCB, and in late 80s yes. and 90s served us with CPCB, and afterwards only he moved to IIT Kanpur. Though I was working in CPCB during that period, our interaction was very limited because I was in the regional offices.
Yes.
However, once I enrolled for the PhD, then only I came across the contributions of Sir and also the importance of air pollution and related issues. Before this period, in fact, in 2014, we have come out with the air quality index. Much before 2014, we refer air quality index developed by Professor Mukesh Sharmaji and IIT Kanpur. And we utilized or we referred his work for the evaluation of our studies. I remember you, sir, late B.P. Shuklaji, the senior environmental engineer, when he was in Bangalore, you came to Bangalore office and we had an interaction that time. I remember that occasion also. As a part of our IITM SEPA network and the 5th International Air Quality Lecture Series, we are very fortunate to have you with us today, sir. And as a teacher, as a true teacher, you are explaining about the air pollution. And in one word, if I can summarize it, you are connecting the research work with people scientifically. And I think we are quite fortunate to have your lecture series. And also we have an overwhelming response from the researchers, regulators, and academicians. Almost above 90 people were attending the lecture series. And we are definitely, we are looking for further technical discussion as a part of our SEPA network research activities, sir. I think the paucity of time, I think we will meet after some time when everything is pandemic situation turns into a regular affair. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thanks, Dr. Madhusudan. Thank you, sir. You would like to say something?
Which Tyagi? Dr. Tyagi or engineer?
Dr. Tyagi, yes, Dr. Tyagi. yeah, you can just unmute yourself. You please go ahead.
Thank you so much, Shivaji, for giving me an opportunity. So I am also lucky enough to work with Dr. Mukesh Sharma in CPCB for quite a long time, till he was there. And we had a lot of field studies in mobile van, having pollution control camps in different states, and stack monitoring at thermal power plant and chemical and fertilizers. And this award you had given to him, Lifetime Achievement Award, he really deserved it. And this is not only his recognition, it is recognition to his scientific contribution to the environmental fraternity, I will say rather. So he is otherwise very well known and he is doing excellent work. He don't deserve, award he deserve at India or abroad. And I last met him only in Kanpur at his residence, and we had cup of tea together a couple of years ago. He was going to WHO He was invited by WHO to deliver a lecture. So with paucity of time, I will not take more time. So I thank him as well as Shiva for organizing such wonderful workshop and lecture series. So I'm very, very happy of today's his excellent presentation also. Thank you.
Thank you very much, sir. So we have Dr. Sengupta is there, B. Sengupta, hope he is listening to us. Sir, can you, it's a very fortunate, and also we have Professor Sharma. So could you please, give your message?
My foundation is from Dr. Sengupta.
Thank you, Professor Shiva Nagendra, and I am extremely happy today to listen again my dear colleague, Professor Mukesh Sharma. In fact, we worked together for almost 40 years now. I was just counting it. I joined CPCB in 1979. He must have joined around 81 or 82, like that. And I am very fortunate that he was associated with me in initial days in CPCB, and he has done some very good work, which I think he has forgotten those documents and things that we are still referring. One of the documents which I want to mention is the stack height criteria. I think Dr. Nilay Chaudhary has praised that concept, what he has given the based upon the mixing height, the stack height criteria for coal-based thermal power station. That was excellent. And later on, he went to Canada for his PhD, and he has done very good work on aluminium industries. Very good. That was also referred worldwide for as a reference document. He come back and then joined IIT Kanpur. And at that time, we have a very good association. When I was member secretary of CPCB, we have initiated the first work on source apportionment study. And he has taken the work for the Kanpur. But he has laid down the foundation of those study. I remember Prashant Ghargav was coordinating the work, and we have very good discussion with Professor Mukesh Sharma, Dr. Rakesh Kumar, then other Terry, Sumit Saxena, Sumit Sharma, etc., on how to do this source apportionment study. And Dr. Sharma's contribution was immense. And after that, he has done also a lot of good work, which are become a milestone in the field of air pollution control, especially some of the work like he has not mentioned, but I know those things like VOC emission control in one of the Gujarat unit. He has done a demonstration plant for VOC control that was very good, and still that was referred by Gujarat Pollution Control Board as a pilot scale study. Dr. Mukesh Sharma, while working in IIT Kanpur, has done tremendous work on the field of air pollution control. We are in touch because he is doing a lot of work for Central Pollution Control Board besides his teaching assignment. And if you visit his website if you do the Google search on Mukesh Sharma's name, you can find out excellent his publication, his lecture notes, his training capsule, etc., which are, I think, very useful for the students. I think a series of lecture notes or video for these lectures are available. Training capsules are available in the Google, in the net. And that was extremely useful for the student to learn how to do the inventory, how to do the modeling, how to do the source apportionment study, how to do the pollution control planning. Everything he has given very nicely. So my good wishes to always with Professor Mukesh Sharma. And we have a very, very, very excellent relationship still. And I wish him very, very good success. And I'm very happy that he got the Lifetime Achievement Award. On that day, I congratulated him also. And all the good wishes and respect and thanks to Shiva Nagendra ji for doing this excellent work. Every month these lectures are very good. And I used to listen all the important lectures which is happening there and learning many new things. Thank you very much.
Thanks very much, sir. So in the interest of time, I would like to Sengupta sir has mentioned, I also started teaching a air pollution control course at IIT Madras, I really watched his lecture. So it is already freely available. NPTEL lectures are available. I learned a lot of things, the way he teaches, the way he explains. So I can be like a student. I learned many things. Of course, he inspired when I was doing my PhD. He came, we had a meeting with Professor Mukesh Kare. So I really had an opportunity to interact with him, learned many things. And I also got a fortunate to work with in one of the project which he was leading. So I mean, it's a quite experience and enriching opportunity and occasion to spend time with him. Now I'll request some students, maybe I am not able to figure out this from the IIT Kanpur or anybody who have just happened to attend some of the lectures, Professor Sharma, and could you please unmute yourself and just say a few words. I'm sorry, I'm not able to. Could you, Arvind Jha, is unmute yourself? No, sorry, I think you are not unmuted. Unmuted.
If nobody is there, Dr. Nagendra, can I come in?
Please. Okay. Maybe because Professor Sharma has already taken a lot of time. I'm apologizing for the extending his time. Maybe in last 5 minutes, we'll close this meeting.
Yes,
so,
sir.
Yeah, please go ahead.
As a student, I first I had opportunity to take some guidance, some lectures from Professor Sharma during the SCRC school in 2007. And thereafter, whenever we met, always I used to put him some questions, and he always used to clear my concept. Whenever we met in some conferences, or sometimes we met in some programs, several things related to air quality standards, and even some modeling studies, he never asked why you are asking or I don't have time. Even during the travel time also, he used to teach us something. So he's so generous and so kind, and we are always thankful to him whenever we met. I never feel that I am not a student. With that one lecture and connection till date, we are very much thankful, and I must congratulate sir for this great achievement award. So thank you, sir. Thank you
very much. Shuklaji, you wanted to say that this is, maybe we'll close it, maybe with just...
Yes, Professor Nagendra, only a few words, because already Sir Sengupta sir has already mentioned about his past things when he was with CPCB. Just I want to tell the people, and because how he is associated with CPCB and government policy making, and for the work what CPCB and other national agencies are doing for pollution control. So revision, the standard which he mentioned are, of course, he was associated with that. And source apportionment studies, many cities he has undertaken, and still for even for CPCB there, he has done a lot of projects. And now this city action plan, everybody referred about city action plan 102 non-attainment cities. He is one of the guiding force for whole concept, as well as even to define the criteria of non-attainment. Because earlier it was exceeding the norm was non-attainment. Now it is a comprehensive criteria wherein non-attainment has been put in place. That is the framework. So he's let me admit that at national level, there are many policies with Niti Aayog, with Ministry of Environment and Forest, through CPCB. He is the person who is constantly giving his inputs and guiding us. And personally, whenever I feel any problem in the field wherein I am working in CPCB in air pollution, I just call Professor Sharma for the guidance. So he is so generous, and he is available most of the time. Thank you, Professor Sharma, for a very insightful lecture today, and keep guiding us, and congratulations for lifetime achievement award. And Professor Shiv Nagendra also for organizing such a wonderful lecture. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Sir, Sharma, sir, last, now over to you, and then we'll close the meeting. If you want to say.
Well, thank you very much for all those very kind words. But always remember, you know, the appreciations are there, which feels makes you feel good. But I'm the one who also believes very seriously in the criticism. And as I said in my talk, the criticism is a strength of the system. So please do tell something, this is not good, this is not, you have been not been able to do. So that will be more inspiring. Thank you very much. Thank you, Dr. Sengupta. Thank you, Dr. Tyagi, Dr. Shukla, Dr. Jha, everyone, you know, and those, and I always enjoy, you know, giving this talk, especially when I see, particularly when the audience is young. So that's that's really excites me, and you know, I really want to encourage them and you know take the challenges. That's what is my motto, and talking to even school children I enjoy a lot actually. Thank you very much, and I greatly appreciate that you invited me, and also for the award, which was I'm really glad that that the award was given, but only the fear I had was the Lifetime Achievement Award means you probably are retiring, no more awards.
No, sir, bring more responsibility. Bring more responsibility.
So that's the feeling I got. Nonetheless, thank you very much. I appreciate everyone. And I'm sure there will be more occasions to meet more in person. And we'll certainly contribute and certainly learn from each other. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, sir. Thank you all the experts and young students, so young researchers working in the air quality management, for all your participations. And special thanks to Professor Mukesh Sharma ji for taking his time, because he's so busy, and always whenever he called, particularly when we talked about a lecture, he said, I am very happy to share. And he said, okay, don't worry, I will we will present it. You wanted to cover the detailed lecture, so I'm thankful to you, sir, for taking your time, for spending valuable your 2 hours with more than 2 hours now with all the younger generations and also the experts. So on behalf of every organizing committee, we would like to thank you all. So Jai Hind, Namaste.
Namaste, Namaste. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.